Hello everyone, good afternoon. So today we will be discussing about management of critically ill patients, which comes under the category of critical care nursing in your critical care module, right? So you can refer to this presentation, and there's a quiz. You have to do the quiz and submit, and at the same time if there are any questions, you can always send those questions to us, right? So without wasting any time, let's move on to the presentation. Management of critically ill patients, right? Critically ill patients normally will be admitted in ICU or intensive care unit. So monitoring of these patients is very much important. Why? Otherwise there will be many adverse sequences. So monitoring in the ICU takes a great place here. Monitoring ensures a rapid detection of changes in clinical status. Yes, to detect any clinical change, monitoring is very important. Yes, monitoring is a must to detect any clinical change. Then allows for accurate assessment of progress and response to therapy. Yes. To assess the patient accurately, the monitoring is important. Then when clinical signs and monitored parameters disagree, assume that clinical assessment is correct. Trends are generally more important than a single reading. Use non-invasive techniques when possible. Alarms are crucial for patient safety. Yes. The fourth point, trends are generally more important than a single reading. Now for an example, let's take a simple one. How does patient's blood pressure change? The trend is more important as nurses. You all know that is very much important in deciding the or the vitals, basically. How the trend happens? Are they getting increased by time or getting decreased with time? The trend is very much important than a single reading. Yes, right. So most of the time the consultants will be focusing on trend of the patient to determine whether the patient is improving or deteriorating, right? Then use non-invasive techniques when possible. Yes, that is very much important, not to prevent or to minimize the harm. We use non-invasive methods as much as possible. Then alarms are crucial for patient safety, of course, because sometimes we might not be monitoring or someone might not be monitoring. So if the values are exceeding the normal values, then there will be an alarm, so everyone will get attention. Otherwise that may go without noticing. So alarms are very much crucial for patient's safety. Right. Now for an example, if the heart rate drops below some level, if there's an alarm, then we know, right? Okay. Then the non-invasive hemodynamic monitoring. Yes, what are the non-invasive monitoring methods here? First one, blood pressure, sphygmomanometer, or in day-to-day use we call that as what? The BP meter or sphygmomanometer, or we use as BP cuff as well. So you all know the technique, how to use the sphygmomanometer and how to check blood pressure using that. Then nowadays there are electronic BP meters as well. Then we have pulse oximeter to check oxygen saturation, or saturation of oxygen, and that is also a non-invasive method, not an invasive method, right? Oxygen saturation is measure of how much oxygen in the blood is carrying as a percentage of the maximum it could carry. Yes, that you know, SpO2. Those things are non-invasive, very basic things, right? Then let's move on to hemodynamic monitoring, the invasive part. The invasive ways of monitoring hemodynamics. First one, is arterial blood pressure monitoring, or we say A line or art lines or arterial line. Then central venous pressure monitoring, then pulmonary artery pressure monitoring, intracranial pressure monitoring, intra-abdominal pressure monitoring. For these things we use invasive methods, okay, not non-invasive. From non-invasive methods it's very hard, or it is very what, those are not very much appropriate, sorry, those are not very much appropriate to check these pressures or these values, so we use invasive methods. So let's move on to see what are the major parts of these invasive monitoring methods. First one, arterial line, or as you all know, A lines, we say art lines, right, or basically arterial lines, right. What is an arterial line? First of all, arterial line is a cannula usually positioned in a peripheral artery, such as radial artery, brachial artery, dorsalis pedis artery, and femoral artery. Again, read, what is an arterial line? Arterial line is a cannula usually positioned in a peripheral artery, such as radial artery, brachial artery, dorsalis pedis artery, and femoral artery. Yes, a cannula which is placed in such arteries, we can call that an arterial line. And you know what is the most common out of here also, that is radial artery. The most common artery to place the A line is a radial artery. Right, then we have femoral artery and brachial artery we can place, but most common site is radial artery. Right, indications for using arterial line. Now we use arterial line to check what? The blood pressure. Yes, right. So what are the indications here? Ease of access. Yes, that is very much easy. Then continuous monitoring of arterial blood pressure. We need this in case if patient is on ionotropic drugs. Then if patient is on vasoactive drugs, if patient requires frequent arterial blood sampling, if the patient needs blood sampling frequently, we can use this method. Then components. Then components of an invasive monitoring device. What are the components of this invasive monitoring device? So what are the parts of this invasive monitoring device? First one, pressure transducer we have, then the dome we have, then pressure tubings we have, then displaying unit we have, then transducer stand we have, then pressure bag with normal saline we have, then catheter set we have. The pressure tubing consists of three main parts. What are those? Arterial extension, the stopcock of the three-way stopcock, and the syringe. Again, read these things. What are the components of an invasive monitoring device? Pressure transducer, dome, pressure tubing consists of arterial extension, stopcock and syringe, display unit, transducer stand, pressure bag with normal saline, and catheter set. Right, so here you can see a set of the equipment or set of art lines or things we use in this invasive monitoring device, the things those are consist of. Right, so here you can refer to these diagrams, and I'm sure that you know how to connect the art line and how to use the art line. So when we get to see each other at IIHS, we can do discuss these things, the practical parts, but for now you can always refer to these diagrams and get an idea. Right. Then, so this is how we insert an arterial line. This is how we insert an arterial line, right? Again, these are the pictures of the process, right? Right, then the way it works. Arterial line connected to the saline fluid non-compressible tube, then to the pressure transducer and automatic flush system, then to the pressure bag. Sorry. Right. The pressure transducer. Pressure transducer is the air miniature rug and disposable device. Air miniature rug, and that's a disposable device. This device can convert the movement of the sensing diaphragm into an electrical signal. What do they do? Convert the movement of diaphragm to an electrical signal. Just like in a case of or in case of any monitoring signals, they convert them into electrical signals. So here the pressure transducer, the movement of diaphragm, it convert that movement of diaphragm or sense that movement and that convert into an electrical signal and shows outside. Then the pressure tubing, the catheter and stopcock are normally attached to the flush device and transducer by non-elastic pressure tubing. Continuous flush device used to fill pressure monitoring system and prevent from clotting into the catheter by continuously flushing fluid through the system at the rate of 1 to 3 milliliters per hour. What is this? Catheter and stopcock are normally attached to the flush device, that we know, then and transducer by non-elastic pressure tubing. Continuous flush device we use to fill pressure monitoring system and to prevent from clotting into the catheter by continuously flushing fluid through the system. We continuously flush this fluid, yes, through the system at the rate of 1 to 3 milliliters per hour. Then the display. Pressure waveform are visualized on calibrated oscilloscope or the display or the monitor. Digital display provide a simple method for presenting quantitative data from the pressure waveform. So we all know that wave, we call it as a pressure waveform, right? So that displays this pressure waveform, the monitor displays the pressure waveform, we call that the waveform, right? The calibration. So that's a mechanism or a process. The accuracy of blood pressure measurement requires an accurate reference point, that is patient's mid-axillary line. Zeroing process is done by closing the patient's side and opening the other end of the three-way to the atmosphere. Now press zero. So this calibration thing, it's very hard to explain throughout this when we get to see each other at the premises after this coronavirus thing is over. So we will discuss about these practical components, right? So here basically there's this there's a picture of leveling and basically leveling. So you know, leveling and zeroing, those things need a mechanism, right? Then arterial pressure. Indications to check arterial pressure, a routine measurement of systemic blood pressure in ICU. So that's a routine measurement. Then multiple blood gas analysis. So if the patient needs blood gas analysis very frequently, so that is an indicator to check this. Then preferable sites are radial, femoral, dorsalis, pedis. Most common is radial, you know. then cannulation, collateral perfusion can be evaluated by modified Allen's test. Right, how to check the collateral perfusion? By pressing the radial and ulnar arteries together and releasing one. So if the palm getting the blood circulation very quickly, or if it return back to the normal state, so we say there's good collateral circulation. Right, the cannula, that's a instyle radial, the 20 gauge cannula. Then single lumen 18 gauge Seldinger technique we use in the Seldinger cannula we use in femoral cases. Right, the complications of the art line are infection. Yes, of course, like surgical site infection, we can get an infection. Then thrombosis, digital ischemia, or less blood supply to the fingers. Then vessel damage could be there. Then bleeding, necrosis, or death of tissue, or hematoma could occur. Right, so this is how a display normally looks like. You can see the waveform, we call that the waveform of this blood pressure, right? This one is the waveform, right? So here you can see the diacrotic notch has been almost disappeared. So that says that the patient is having a non-compliant the system tend to be non-compliant. So we will discuss these things once we get to see right each other. The arterial waveform, here the arterial waveform, or practically this one, okay, arterial waveform reflects the pressure generated in the arteries following ventricular contraction and can be described as having anacrotic notch, peak systolic pressure, diacrotic notch, and diastolic pressure. Okay, anacrotic notch, peak systolic pressure, diacrotic notch, and diastolic pressure. Right, so here is the diacrotic notch when the pressure backfires. Okay, when the heart pumps, and when heart relaxes, the pressure backfires. So that's the diacrotic notch. Right. Is it accurate? Now we take this blood sample and the through arterial pressure through art lines, but there might be always a problem. Is it accurate? Whether this is accurate or not. So now we know how the arterial pressure monitoring system works. We need to be able to decide whether or not the trace BP in numerical format is accurate. Failure to notice this may lead to unnecessary or mistreatments for our patients. There are two main abnormal tracing problems that can occur once the monitor gain is set correctly. Now, there are two main problems that can occur. First one is damp trace. Okay, here is the normal one, here is the overdamped trace. Okay, then the damping here, the damp, the normal and the overdamped one, or the damp one. Damping occurs due to air bubbles overly compliant or distensible tubing, catheter kinks, or you know, some problem or some notches, kinks, then clots, injection ports, low flush bag pressure, or no fluid in the flush bag. So if these things are there, then the damping could occur. Damping could occur. These type of trace underestimates blood pressure. Here, these type of trace underestimate blood pressure. Now pay attention. Here, the blood pressure varies from here to here, but this here, the trace from here to here, blood pressure. So that underestimate, real pressure is like this, but it measures pressure like this, up to this level. Right. Then we have resonant trace, or we call that underdamped trace. Here This was over dam. Here, under dam trails. Let's see the reasons for that. Resonant or spike trails. Resonant trails occurs due to O. Under dam trails occur due to long tubes. Oval is stiff or non-compliant tubing. Increase vascular resistance. Reverberations in tubing causing harmonics that disorder the trace, like high systolic and low diastolic, non fully open stopcock valve. So if the stopcock valve is not fully open, that may also lead to a underdamped trace or resonant or spike trace. So such kind of a trace overestimate blood pressure. Here, overestimates blood pressure. Right. So here, the real blood pressure from here to here, but here the blood pressure from here to here more than 150 shows, but the real blood pressure is somewhat different. So this is a underdamped trace or resonant or spike trace, we say. Right, now pay attention to this point. Now let's imagine if the systolic or if the diastolic blood pressure is 50 and systolic blood pressure is 150. The gap between systolic and diastolic blood pressures, we call that gap as pulse pressure. Now here the pulse pressure is 100. Yes, systolic is 150, diastolic is 50. So the pulse pressure is 100, 150 minus 50, or the gap between these two, so that is 100. Removal of an arterial line. So this is maybe you have done many times. So removal of the arterial line, this is an aseptic procedure. Remember, universal precautions. The procedure should be explained to the patient. Take dressing offline, remove arterial line, ensuring that the entry to site is covered with gauze. Apply digital pressure for at least 5 minutes to ensure hemostasis, to stop bleeding. Dress site with gauze and micropore. Assess the peripheral circulation as thrombosis can occur after removal. So basic stuff, and you are very familiar with those things. I'm not going to stress on those points. Right, then we are moving on to the next invasive monitoring method. What is a central line? Central line is a catheter that provides venous access via the superior vena cava or right atrium. In a central line, remember, we always get the venous access, not arterial access, and venous access we get through superior vena cava or right atrium. So that we call a central line. Here the central venous pressure, remember, that's not arterial access, this is venous access. So this is how central venous pressure is shown on monitor. Common central line insertion sites. What are the common sites? Right internal jugular vein, left internal jugular vein, right subclavian vein, left subclavian vein, or femoral vein as the last resort or last point. Again, let's repeat again. Right internal jugular, left internal jugular, right subclavian, left subclavian, and femoral. Or peripherally inserted central catheters, PICCs, peripherally inserted central catheter, PICCs, which are inserted via the antecubital veins. Basilic vein is the best, they have said, in the arm, man is advancing to the central veins. Right. So types of central lines, these are the types: single lumen, triple lumen, quadruple lumen, and quintuple lumen. So here you can see how a central line looks like to outside. So central venous pressure, CVP, indications to check this pressure are fluid administration. If we admit fluid to the patient, so we need to check the venous pressure. TPN, hypertonic solutions, vasoactive infusions, monitoring for right atrial pressure, central venous pressure, right, in through this axis we can get to right atrium. So to check the right atrial pressure, we can use this method. Preparable sites are internal jugular, subclavian, brachial, femoral, as we mentioned before. Methods of central venous pressure, CVP monitoring. There are two methods of CVP monitoring. What are those? Manometer system and transducer system. Manometer system means enables intermittent reading and is less accurate than the transducer system. Enables continuous reading, which are displayed on a monitor. So those two things, but here we use the you all know the transducer system. Right. What are the complications of central CVP or central venous pressure? Those are at insertion. What are the complications we can get? Arterial puncture, pneumothorax, hemothoraxis. While we insert, we can get accidentally a puncture. We can accidentally we can cause pneumothorax. It can cause pneumothorax. Or accident puncture could cause hemothorax. So everything that depends. Passage of wire or catheter. That means what? The complications could occur in passage of wire or in catheter. What are those? Arrhythmias, perforation of superior vena cava and right atrium. Then thrombosis and catheter embolism. So these are the basic equipments we use to check central venous pressure. Maybe you have seen, not maybe, definitely you have seen. So these are the basic instruments. Right, then pulmonary artery pressure, another small topic, and here is the equipment which we use to check pulmonary artery pressure, and that looks so nice. Right, the indications for pulmonary artery pressure are hemodynamic measurements like cardiac output, stroke volume, systemic vascular resistance, measurement of right heart pressure to check the measurement of right heart pressure, then acute pulmonary hypertension. If there's a pulmonary embolism, if there's a cardiac tamponade, an estimation or preload or left heart filling, if you want to check the estimation or if you want to check the preload, then derivation of oxygen variables to check the oxygen levels. Right, the CVP or central venous pressure waveform reflect changes in right atrial pressure during the cardiac cycle. The right atrial pressure changes here when relaxing. What happens? Yes, it shows right during diastole gain pressure. What happens to the pressure during diastole? That lows, right? Then pressure increases, then again decreases. So it's like that. Management of a patient with a CVP line. How to do? Monitor the patient for signs and complications. Label CVP line with drug and fluids being infused in order to minimize the risk of accidental bolus injection. And if you don't use, flush the cannula regularly to help prevent thrombosis. A 500 ml bag of 0.9 normal saline should be maintained at a pressure of 300 mercury millimeters. So these things you may have seen in hospital, and most of y'all, you know these things, but I want you to remember these things, and once we get to see each other in a physical manner, we'll be discussing these things into detail. Right, so again, the management of a patient with CVP line. To ensure all connections are secure to prevent exsanguination, introduction of infection and emboli, observe insertion site frequently. Yes, that we all know, the observing of the insertion site. The length of the indwelling catheter should be recorded and regularly monitored. CVP line should be removed when clinically indicated. Yes. So, if that is clinically indicated, of course, we have to remove the line.
Removal of central line, that includes, this is an again aseptic procedure. Patient should be spine with head tilt down. Ensure no drugs are attached and running via central line. Remove dressing. Cut the stitches. Slowly remove the catheter. If there's a resistance, then call for assistance. Apply digital pressure with gauze until bleeding stop. Dress with gauze and clear dressing Tegaderm. Okay. Right. So that is basically about managing patients in intensive care units. If you have questions, you have our Viber number, WhatsApp number, you can always, or email, you can always send your questions to us. We will be more than happy to answer. And we hope to see you, you all very soon at IIHS. And we want you all to be safe and to use this time in a very efficient manner. Right. Thank you very much for your time. We will see each other very soon, and hope you all, everyone of you all, to be very safe. Thank you again.